So up next, we have Xenia for who is going to do a talk around API security in high-risk scenarios. I think Xenia has a background in quantum security, and I'm sure this is going to be a super interesting one. So over to you.
Yes, hi everyone. First, I'm happy that I'm invited to talk here. And yeah, I'm going to tell you a little bit in general on API protection on highly volatile threat landscapes. So first, why do I think I can talk about this? The expertise we offer in Quantix includes information and IT security, as well as information risk management. So this is the part where you usually look at the information which is being processed in your systems in order to decide which kind of measures is needed to implement appropriate protection. Then we have a strong background in post-quantum security. We were very active in the last years in this area with analyzers and support of standardization processes. Because we need to look at the quantum solution of a cryptographic algorithm for a post-quantum security analysis, we also got into the topic of quantum algorithms. And last but not least, we also have a little system and algorithm engineering team. So, we are very active in industrial scientific projects. One of them is integration of quantum technologies to classical infrastructures. This concerns various aspects, for example, quantum random number generators or supporting investigation of protocols for quantum communication. Yeah, and with the quantum algorithms, as quantum computing is the least far developed area of quantum technologies, we are still in very early stage, like making basic tests of functions with available processors. So, what we do is also investigation of open questions in post-quantum security. For that, we have an ongoing open source project. The link you see here, it's about a so-called quantum algebraic attack. There are still some open questions, and whoever wants to contribute to this project is invited to do so. Good. So, as well, the area of quantum feasibility studies of algorithmic problems. Yeah, we have several associations with scientific bodies, but also, of course, we are active in the industry. So, why is cryptography so unique in information security? If you look at a connection between two companies or instances, we have in the networks, various measures to protect our data, security event monitoring, intrusion detection systems, intrusion protection systems, endpoint protection in general, malware protection, access controls, and so on. But at the moment, the data leaves the company and is just in transfer. We only have one single protection, and this is cryptography. That's why it is very it deserves a very special focus from our point of view. So at the moment or in these current times, we are facing several threats which are evolving unpredictably or maybe even very fast. So, if you are looking at the cryptography stack, let's start from the top layer. The first question is a mathematical problem, and the complexity of this mathematical problem in a cryptographic algorithm determines the basic security of the cryptography. Then, the next step is the implementation of this problem to program like computer scientific solution. in a way that you have to phrase it before you can implement it. That's why I have another layer, implementation. And when it comes to implementation, we have several more attack vectors to such a crypto system, which does not only depend on mathematics, but also on system integration, computing processes, and so on, like system architecture and several aspects. Then the next difficulty is the integration to application, and then the network dependencies. And not to be underestimated are the top layers like administration, management, and users. Even if you look at the most simple aspect of cryptography, having certificates on a server, we have globally very much challenges and problems in keeping these certificates up to date and valid. Good, and that's why we have in general three kind of big threats. The first one is increasing performance of binary technologies, tools like OCL Hashcat and so on. Then we have new mathematical solutions which offer full cryptanalysis of given problems, like, for example, discrete logarithm over certain fields. And then last but not least, the quantum computing. For a very long time, everybody said we don't know when the time is ripe. NIST already determined decided in 2017 to go for the standardization, even though they couldn't estimate when we have to migrate to post-quantum cryptography. But the impact of classical cryptography being invalid would be globally a catastrophe. That's why they started with this standardization, which will be finalized soon. They are in the last round now. So, yes. Let's look a little bit closer, like high-performance attack vectors, which are currently available. The threats, password and cryptographic cracking tools, Hashcat and similar tools, which are open source tools and anyone who wants to use them can use them. Then we have aggregated computing resources and parallelization of attack processes, and the new mathematical solutions affecting parameters and configuration of classical cryptography. Countermeasures: regularly check the RFCs and recommendations of official data protection and InfoSec institutes for first choice of algorithms, then key length, and also algorithm parameter configuration. And update your systems accordingly in alignment with depending parties. So the near future threats, and before I said we didn't know when we have strong enough quantum computers to break our current cryptographies, but there are estimations from various instances like the MIT or IBM, which guess that we might have a problem by 2023, and that's really near time. We all know that it is really not easy to migrate complex infrastructures to new systems or new modules or whatever. And it is probably the same with the certificates. So what is affected? Evolving quantum computing technologies will make it possible to decrypt data, which is encrypted by first Diffie-Hellman, second RSA, and third elliptic curves are also affected. The countermeasures are the new post-quantum crypto algorithms. If you are already interested in them, I recommend you to look at the NIST standardization round 3. There they have the finalists, And for all aspects like key exchange and also digital signatures. Then we have homomorphic encryption. I don't know yet how interesting this will be for APIs, but I wanted to mention it. Homomorphic encryption offers the possibility to edit encrypted data without decrypting it. The current state of these algorithms is that they are still very slow, but for certain very highly, for certain processes which demand high privacy, this could be interesting as well. So DARPA is working with that for some kind of processes. Yeah, it's a very interesting area. Then we have quantum communication. So of course, here this is new hardware we are talking about, not no software anymore. And it will also be expensive in the beginning. But it's also interesting to look at because many people cannot distinguish between quantum cryptography and post-quantum cryptography. Starting to read into this topic will be helpful for anything you consider going forward. By the way, quantum cryptography is a little bit misleading. So quantum cryptography actually only concerns the key exchange part of encrypted communication. So still in such a setup, you will need an encryption algorithm and partner authentication, which is mathematically based. Good. So how can you identify assets of high privacy criticality by an information risk assessment? That would be the first steps. Yeah, first, what is your asset? The business process and the respective IT systems. And the first step would be to perform a CIA rating on your systems which are connected to the APIs. This will indicate the protection need of the APIs themselves. So the best candidates for post-quantum cryptography are the ones which process data which needs to remain confidential for many years in the future. Even though, even if it takes another 10 years until quantum computers are a real threat to our currently used cryptography, data collectors collect the data since many years because they are waiting for the moment in time when they can take a quantum computer and decrypt what they have collected. The best candidates for near-time transition to homomorphic encryption are the ones with high confidentiality and integrity classification and low availability rating. Yes, because they are slow. That's why I said the last point. The second would be then to perform an information risk assessment to consider threats versus the system's protection need. This will help you determine which new cryptography you might want to apply to which system or API. Yeah, and here I have a link with a guide by the NIST how to conduct a risk assessment. So, conclusion: stay aware about upcoming threats and solutions and introduce swift crypto patch processes. This is also a recommendation by official security bodies. Thank you very much.
Zenia, thank you so much. That's super interesting. So, I mean, it's interesting to hear that you've been working on this since 2017, and IBM predicts that this is going to start to become implemented in 2023, was it, if I remember correctly?
Yes, right.
So, you know, this you're kind of looking at the next frontier of security for IT systems. So, in your from your perspective, what do you see are the maybe the early use cases or the early applications of quantum security?
A sensible decision would be to look at data which needs to remain confidential for a long time. For example, critical personal data. So, For example, with payment, I'm not so sure actually. Yeah, I have noticed that the banks are not so alert about this topic. So I ask myself, maybe they don't care as much for long-term confidentiality of transactions. I don't know. Yeah. So, but very critical would be things like identity cards. You know, wherever you have a hardware update involved.
Yeah.
Imagine we have our passports, digital passports.
Exactly. I mean, every day you seem to hear about another company, you know, exposing confidential data, etc. And, you know, it's a huge barrier to that information being people trusting the digital systems that are much more efficient and much more you know, operationally viable. So, you know, it'd be super interesting to see how, you know, those early stage applications are introduced and the benefits that it can bring. I mean, just as the kind of, you know, the digital asset sector starts to really, I guess, grow and be adopted by traditional finance, you know, those security processes, you know, there's highly sensitive information involved in adopting digital assets there. So how do you see the convergence of, bless you, how do you see the convergence of perhaps, you know, digital asset adoption on a en masse and the introduction of quantum security?
And so I think it would be interesting to just start working also on APIs, with, for example, if you have a server-browser relation, then it's more or less easy. So if you control the client yourself, then it's rather easy to enable this. And there are already companies which offer post-quantum cryptography certificates in a test run. Yeah. So some of them even do it for free at the moment. Okay. And I haven't included this in the link, but I will check it. Will you share the slides afterwards with the...
I believe so, yes. I believe the slides are available for the viewers to see. So yeah, if there's a link to include in that, that'd be very interesting for everybody.
Yeah, I think so as well, because I have just last week found a company who does this, and there are several also API solutions for this, where I'm not so sure if I really would go for it, because I mean, usually you should control the private key on your own server. Yes.
Yeah.
So
yeah,
I haven't looked very closely into that. It seemed a little bit too scientific to me, the solution.
Okay. Okay, yeah. Interesting. Yeah. So it's just another question that came to mind during that. So you referenced the standardization of quantum security and you know, kind of recognizing some kind of, yeah, as you say, standards that can be adopted across the world, you know, in different regulatory environments. How do you foresee that? How do you foresee that playing out over maybe the next 2 or 3 years?
As soon as the NIST has finalized their contest, they will integrate chosen algorithms into the OpenSSL libraries. Okay. And maybe also other libraries. So, yeah, I mean, you can also wait to that point in time. I know that there are several hardware producers which started to integrate hardware implementations of post-quantum secure algorithms already some years ago. Yeah. And they dare to do it before we have the standardization process finalized, but usually they work with the designers of these kind of algorithms as well. So
super interesting. I mean, I never thought about the standardization of algorithms before, but actually I guess that is going to become just more and more important over the next decade, right? You know,
for crypto, it's like a really, it's a requirement. And this is also the reason why I decided not to produce crypto products with my own company. We are only consulting, because the way from production to sale is such a long one, and it's very uncertain. I mean, There are like a lot of scientists who have worked 20 years on an algorithm. And after 20 years, the NIST just says, it's a good one, but we have a better one out. Yeah. So that's the way it goes. Yeah.
Interesting, very interesting. So yeah, so I mean, just a, another question as well. So around the hardware that you mentioned, and I guess the barriers, maybe it's, you know, catching up with the software. Sometimes it's the other way around, but you know, in this instance, the hardware, I guess, is a barrier to entry for kind of mass adoption as well as the algorithm standards. What could you share a little bit more around the state of the hardware and from a quantum perspective, and maybe what needs to happen over the next few years?
I'm not so up to date in this area. I just randomly had some insight that the producers like Infineon and the like are already producing these kind of chips. I can say I tried to raise the awareness of governmental bodies for digital passports and the like in the last years, because many are now producing this kind of hardware, yes, and none of them included post-quantum cryptography. So we can expect there will be a lot of work in the next years.
I mean, you know, being in the UK, we have to go in the longer Brexit in the passport queues to get the passport through. So only just this week, I was thinking, you know, there must be a better way to have than having a physical passport. So, you know, those systems, you know, the barrier of adoption, it'd be very interesting to see how the, you know, the online side of things is adopted. How have you found the impact of the pandemic on people looking at quantum security with the kind of en masse sharing of maybe personal data and you know, sensitive health data in some cases? Have you seen a reaction to the last year's events?
Critical. I can also mention several aspects. So this concerns a lot. I mean, we are working from home with our private devices, many from us. And I mean, for example, a post private key is only as secure as our devices. So platforms,
Absolutely.
cryptography without platform security is worth nothing. So that's the first thing. And then there's a very interesting instance in the UK, the CyberSec Innovation Partners. They are doing continuous global scans of state of cryptographic certificates. And actually, if you hear the guy talk, it's a disaster. They find these invalid certificates everywhere. And often a server with an invalid certificate is an entry point for everything else, like ransomware and so on.
Interesting. In a serverless, maybe Web3 ecosystem, how do you see quantum playing out with no single central place to hold that private key? Do you see it? Do you see that becoming a more secure environment for quantum, or do you think that's going to change the rules a little bit?
You mean like, for example, blockchain platform infrastructures?
Yeah, DLT infrastructures with distributed processing of transactions. Do you see that becoming a kind of, you know, changing how people perceive quantum and where their data is stored, or do you see that as a something which is not maybe a decade or so away?
My first remark to that is like, I don't know any DLT system which does not have server-client relations. They don't talk about that, but I mean, they are communicating with each other with client-server protocols always. And I can say that even if you have like the logical infrastructure is not server-client based but distributed, they are using very complex protocols, some of which might be post-quantum secure, but we don't know yet. So recently we had some approaches from these kind of providers asking us to start looking at these protocols.
Interesting. Interesting. I There's no, I don't know if there's any questions from the audience or if there's anything else that people may want to ask. Let me just have a quick look through here. So data protection, you'll find so yeah, there's no further questions from the crowd. I mean, yeah, I think the standardization of algorithms is a super interesting concept. I'd be really interested to see how that plays out at a global level in different regulatory environments and how each country sort of responds to those standards. You know, we all know kind of standardizations of things takes a long time, and I'm sure this is going to be a new frontier in possibly, you know, the next kind of level of security for enterprise. So yeah, Xenia, thanks so much for joining us and for talking today. Super interesting to hear about it. And I believe that is the time.
Yeah, thank you very much.
You're welcome.